Hi guys, I'm Ben from Adaptalux and this is Sam, and welcome back to another macro photography video.
A few months ago, Adaptalux was invited to collaborate with the Biological Photography and Imaging course here at Nottingham University. Today we are going to explore a wide range of specimens, from dinosaur bones to well-preserved insects.
Yeah, so we're doing a little bit of a different video today. We're on a bit of a recon mission to see what kind of other subjects they have here in their collection. But first of all, we'd like to learn a little bit more about this course because it's not too self-explanatory. Sam's just nipped off to go and have a look around, but in the meantime, I've grabbed Steve from the university. Steve, what is it that you do here exactly?
So here at Biological Photography and Imaging, we take scientists or students from a scientific background, and we equip them with skills in photography, filmmaking, design, that's magazine design, book design, web design, and other creative skills in terms of writing and things like that. And just basically pad out their skill set for their future career endeavors, usually through image communication or to work in the creative industries.
Cool, so there's a strange eclectic mix of both camera equipment next to strange specimens. I suppose that helps people coming from a scientific background to be able to use their skills in subjects that they know.
Yeah, or even sometimes subjects they don't know. Sometimes, you know, just giving them a subject that they might not have come across and say, could you image this in a way that, you know, would help communicate it to the layperson in the best way. It's just preparing them for future work. So using studio lighting and doing studio photography, shoot things on different backgrounds under different lighting circumstances. Mm-hmm. Just, I mean, if they can photograph any of these subjects, as you know yourself, you can then apply it to anything.
What do your students usually go on to do? What's their sort of career path after biological photography and imaging?
Career path, there isn't no set career path, unfortunately. Everybody who's graduated from us has gone on to do very diverse, fantastic work. Beforehand, we've had a student graduate and become a food photographer, so his stuff's all in the supermarket, Sainsbury's, Morrison's, that sort of thing. We've had people go on to be wildlife camera people on BBC and other production companies, Channel 4, that sort of thing, working with Attenborough and stuff like that. We've had people go on to become in-house graphic designers, magazines, conservation projects, photographers in their own right, doing their own businesses, filmmakers. It's really wide ranging. Of course, things like medical photography, dental photography. Some have stayed in education and gone to do PhDs. That might have involved a bit more scientific imaging further down the line. Honestly, every student that comes in, picks up the skill set, and it seems like no two people tend to really go do the same thing.
Well, that's the joy of the creative arts, yeah, like this, absolutely. I suppose. Lots of transferable skills, and it's fantastic to have all of this inspiration around here, all of these different subjects, and that's exactly what we're going to be looking at today, taking a look around and seeing if we can find some inspiration of things that you guys might want to see in the future. So let's find Sam and have a look at what he's found. Is there anything interesting out here, Sam?
Yeah, lots of interesting things. So this is one of the many cabinets with a vast selection of different skeletons and skulls. So down here, there's a chimpanzee skeleton, for example. Here, there's some sort of perch, which is a type of kind of freshwater fish. And then all the way over here, there is an American black bear skull, which is pretty cool. So there's quite a good selection here.
Do you think some of these are gonna be interesting in macro?
Yeah, I think so. So obviously some of the larger things, maybe not, but what I'm doing is I'm taking kind of like my eye to the smaller details within the larger subjects. So for example, in these skulls here, you're looking at the texture of the bone, the areas around the teeth, so this kind of area here. And then certain subjects like the detail of this kind of bone marrow inside there, which is very interesting. So yeah, but rather than looking at the bigger kind of bones, we're kind of looking at the closer details within that larger subject.
Yeah, so some of that's certainly going to be interesting macro. Let us know down in the comments if you want to see some of this even closer up.
Ben, these look interesting. So what's going on over here?
Stuff in jars, by the looks of it. All sorts of weird things in all sorts of different jars. We've got everything from like octopuses, yeah. to assorted reptiles in alcohol.
Lovely.
I think all of this stuff is going to be interesting if we can figure out a way to get past the reflective surfaces of all of these glass jars. As I'm, you know, moving this light around, I'm just trying to figure out if it's possible to get light in here and get a clear picture of what's inside without it just being all reflections. And of course, some of these are quite dark as well, as there's a lot of sediment and darker color inside these watery jars. So yeah, this might be really interesting if we can get a nice clear picture through the outside of the jar, which will be an interesting technique to look at as well. So again, let us know down in the comments if you if you'd like to see us try and get some pictures of whatever's inside these jars. Looks like Sam's found his way into another collection room. What have we got in here, Sam?
A lot of different things in here. So we've got stuffed birds, stuffed animals. Over here, we've got a wide selection of different preserved insects, some common and some really rare.
Is that a tarantula?
Yeah, I try not to look at that one. But yeah, that is a huge, I believe it's a Brazilian tarantula of some sort, which very interesting as a macro subject. I'm not sure I'm gonna shoot that one though. And then over here, we've got some more bones, some preserved kind of lizards. This is roundworm from a dog, which is pretty gross, but also interesting. This is an elephant tooth, which weighs, yeah, it's quite heavy. So it gives you kind of an impression how much an elephant weighs. And then here we've got a narwhal, that's the one. A narwhal tusk, which is really pretty cool. And again, macro-wise, looking at the kind of details with lines on here, I think would be pretty interesting. And then behind you, Ben, is, so we did the tutorial on shark teeth a year or so ago. So this is a jaws of a shark. And in here, you can see all the teeth. So as they regenerate and push through, which is really cool. So you can see how many teeth shark lose and then regain over a lifetime. But yeah.
There really is so many different subjects, isn't there? Where,
yeah, definitely.
I keep saying that we're spoilt for choice, but I think this gives you guys a good impression of how much choice there actually is here when it comes to different varieties of subjects. Once again, just let us know if there's anything that you're seeing here that you think would make a really interesting macro subject. I mean, arguably everything would, but there's only so much time and so many videos that we can make on this stuff. So do let us know down in the comment section if anything catches your eye. So what's going on in these cabinets?
So here we have thousands of different insects, basically. So we have drawers upon drawers of different beetles, wasps, bees, spiders, you name it really, from all over the world. So yeah, we're very lucky to have access to this kind of a variety of insect life. So here there's a common milkweed locust from South Africa. And then if I go to the drawers over here, we've got a wide range of different beetles. So,
and some of these beetles have got that same sort of iridescence that we saw on the butterfly that we were shooting a few weeks ago. So that will certainly be really interesting to get close up on if you guys want to see more of that strange coloration that happens on these insects.
Yeah, so again, if there's anything what's catching your eye, in these drawers, you know, small or large, then yeah, let us know in the comments and we'll get them out and try and photograph them.
So check out these moths. I know that we've looked at a lot of moths and butterflies already, but these ones over here in particular are really interesting because I'm sure that some of you are going to recognize these. This is the death's head hawk moth. You can see on the back of the thorax here a little skull pattern, and some of you will recognize this from the Silence of the Lambs. So I think this would be a really interesting moth to take a look at in particular and just capture some of those details and maybe get a closer look at that eerie looking skull on its back.
So I know this has been a bit of a different video compared to our usual macro photography tutorials, but I really hope it's given you a really good insight into the very large collection that we are really lucky to have access to.
And I know that we've said it a few times already, but we would really like to hear from you guys on what has caught your eye today, if there's any subjects or techniques that you'd like us to focus in on while we're here at Nottingham University, because this is a really great opportunity to get access to a lot of subjects that we wouldn't normally be able to see, and we want to let you guys experience that along with us. For now though, that is all that we've got time for. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next time.